Okay, welcome back to our afternoon panel. We're going to talk about what's next and the regional trends. Professor Fair is on her way. She'll join us in about 10 minutes or so. So we'll get started, and I will introduce her when she gets here. So we'll just change our order here a little bit. Just to introduce things, I think I'm reminded of a great book by Elliot Cohen and John Gooch called Military Misfortune. And all military failures are a result of three things: failure to learn, failure to adapt, and failure to anticipate. And so I think we do a pretty good job of learning, pretty good job of adapting, but of course anticipation is the hardest thing. And I think that's what this conference is all about, and I hope that we're able to anticipate what we might see in the future. And we started out very well looking at that this morning. I'm also a big fan of Frank Hoffman and understanding. You know, he actually advocates a principle of war, understanding. Sometimes, though, I think we spend more time trying to name things with the gray zone and hybrid warfare and irregular warfare and political warfare. And we spend more time naming things than we do understanding the essence of the phenomena or the challenges that we face. And I also think especially from this morning's talk, and I think the way we'll proceed in the next few days, and I'm reminded of Professor Hoffman's book, Inside Terrorism. And I wish that he'd change his third edition when it comes out next summer to Inside Political Violence. I think people don't often read his whole definition of terrorism. You know, it's about the political objectives. You know, it's political violence. And I wish he'd change the name to Inside Political Violence. Because, you know, the way I look at the world today, there's really three main powers that I see. Revisionist powers that seek to undermine the international system and change it for their own benefit. The revolutionary powers that seek to destroy the international system and replace it with their own. And then the modern nation state powers that seek to protect the international system, the nation state system, and make it work for all. And I think that today we see a clash of those powers. We've heard a lot about revolutionary powers, how I would term Al-Qaeda and ISIS and others. But it really kind of, to me, I come back to Clausewitz and I think about what he said, you know, that war is politics by other means. I think the revolutionary powers and the revisionist powers, but the revolutionary powers in particular, turn that on its head. You know, politics is war by other means. And I think that we forget that, or we don't learn that, and we focus too much on terrorism and not on the political objectives those terrorists are trying to achieve. And so today I hope that that we will spend some time trying to anticipate and understand, and we've got a great panel to do that. First we'll have David Gartenstein-Ross, who is an American counterterrorism scholar, analyst, the chief executive officer of Valens Global, that consults on counterterrorism, Al-Qaeda, ISIS, or ISIL, and other insurgent groups and violent non-state actors. He's a senior fellow at the Foundation for Defense of Democracies, and he's also an adjunct professor here at Georgetown, and can conduct research in five languages. And particular for this talk, he's the author of numerous publications, one including Bin Laden's Legacy and Why We're Still Losing the War on Terrorism. We also have Uta Klausen, who is currently a fellow at the Woodrow Wilson Center and the Lawrence A. Wien Professor of International Cooperation at Brandeis University. Uta is a founder of the Western Jihadism Project, which is a data collection and archive focused on Islamist extremist groups in the West. And at Brandeis, she leads a team who are studying Islamic terrorist networks. And her current project at the Wilson Center is Democracy is Forbidden, the Western Roots of the Jihadist Movement. Lastly, Diego Muro of our colleague, our partner, University, the University of St. Andrews, at the Honda Center for the Study of Terrorism and Political Violence, the one organization that has terrorism and political violence together. I think probably some influence there from Professor Hoffman and Professor English and the like there. But his main research interests are terrorism, ethnic conflict, social movements, and comparative politics. And he's the author of Ethnicity and Violence, The Case of Radical Basque Nationalism, the co-editor of Politics and Memory of the Memory of the Transition, the Spanish Model, and From Bullets to Ballots. And he's currently working on another book on the effectiveness of terrorism that should be published this year. And so we look forward to that. And I will introduce Professor Fair when she arrives. So at this time, I'll turn it over to David.
Dave, thank you so much. It's really an honor to be here at this conference, and it's been an honor to be associated with SSP, which is one, you know, the finest program of its kind in the nation for 4 years now. So there's an interesting debate, about violent non-state actors, which concerns whether we've seen this all before. There's an article which I've taken to assigning in my classes by Reiko Huang, called The Islamic State is an Ordinary Insurgency. It's a very well-argued piece. Probably each step in the chain is entirely logical and follows from the one before, and I think it's entirely wrong. And assign it for that reason. It's something you have to think about to understand what it gets wrong. It argues that ISIS is something we've precisely seen before. In many ways, ISIS is, right? We've certainly seen extraordinarily brutal movements before. We've seen insurgencies that capture and hold territory and govern before. But I think that there are things that are very different now when you look at the sum total of how they fit together. If you look at violent non-state actors in the world, they're able to use deadlier force than they ever have, with attacks becoming increasingly bloody and body counts going up. They're able to mobilize faster than they ever could. The mobilization of ISIS in particular is unprecedented in its speed. They're able to mobilize far more broadly across more geographic regions when they're not connected to a nation-state sponsor. If you look at the Cold War, obviously you had communist violent non-state actors throughout the world. But the fact that you had a Soviet proxy situation makes it different than what we're seeing. These violent non-state actors that can operate on a truly transnational scale across 50, 60 countries, but don't have a state sponsor driving it. And finally, you have weaker states in the backdrop than we've seen since we saw the Westphalian state become so dominant during the 20th century, a century that I refer to as the Westphalian moment. I think the Westphalian moment is falling behind. We're no longer in a world where states can be presumed to organize along Westphalian lines. And so when you look at the combination of violent non-state actors themselves with technology and environment, we're looking at something which is different than what we've seen. Now, you heard remarks this morning that segue into what I want to say, which I could summarize as terrorism is bad and it's getting worse. I think that's absolutely correct. Anybody who's paying attention would, I think, agree with that. Not just terrorism. The reason I use the term violent non-state actors is because a lot of these groups don't fall simply within the terrorism label. I agree with Dave that we overuse the term terrorism. Within the MENA region, one of the major trends has been, of course, the Al-Qaeda-ISIS competition. And one thing I think that is worth acknowledging in any discussion of this kind is that the problem set of violent non-state actors has often been misunderstood by analysts. If you look back to what people were saying a couple of years ago, the vast majority within the field were calling this competition for ISIS. Right? ISIS was supposed to come in, fundamentally disrupt the Al-Qaeda network. There was a chance that Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula or Shabab would defect entirely and go over to ISIS. That, of course, didn't happen. This is not to say ISIS is going to go away, but it's perceptibly weakened. Al-Qaeda is perceptibly stronger. And if you look back to 2014, the ways in which it strengthened were entirely predictable. You know, we could see it happening then. What Al-Qaeda had wanted to do for a long time was to change the way it was viewed. We could see this in bin Laden's documents in Abbottabad, where he talked about the branding problem for Al-Qaeda, even thought about changing its name, which they did, by the way, as they expanded into North Africa and used front groups with the Ansar al-Sharia label and things like that. They had an opportunity to distinguish themselves from ISIS. If you look at Al-Qaeda's propaganda, they have absolutely pivoted. They refer to ISIS as being the true Khawarij or Kharijites, referring to an early extremist sect in Islam's history. They've positioned themselves without moderating at all as with more within the mainstream of regional politics. And we can see the results. Al-Qaeda today is able to operate more openly than it ever has. Like, this is absolutely clear within the region. You know, the kind of charities that the US worked so hard to shut down just after the 9/11 attacks are back in business, supporting Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda branches in places like Syria and even Libya are receiving support from states, often through intermediaries, often masked, but it's happening, and we know that it's happening. You know, this is the problem. The mainstreaming of Al-Qaeda, their ability to operate openly, is a major problem. The reason why I say we need to understand how the problem set has often been misdiagnosed is because it gets to that overarching question of what do we do? Now, when we look at that, one of the fundamental problems we have is that we have a 21st century problem in violent non-state actors, one that fundamentally connects to the kind of technologies that are being used and developed. And we have a 20th century architecture, if that, to try to combat it. One of the analogies I use frequently is that of startup industries versus legacy industries, which we see in the economic sphere. When you look to the economic sphere, when you look at behemoth companies like Blockbuster Video or Borders Books, you know, companies that ended up being displaced, one of the fundamental reasons why they weren't able to survive the competition they were involved in is because they had a business model that was wedded to the era in which they began. You know, for Borders, which went out of business about 6 years ago, had originally been founded on technological advances. The Borders brothers from Michigan had what they called the book inventory system, which was in 1971 absolutely state of the art. They were able to take they were able to understand local preferences in bookstores, not just take the national bestseller list and stock their stores with bestsellers, but actually understand what people wanted to read locally and match the books they carried to local preferences. State of the art then. They never caught up to the internet boom. Amazon went online in 1995. Borders did not have a website until 1998. By the early 21st century, you started to get Kindle and e-readers, and Borders eventually tried that, I believe, in 2008. They had this thing, this Borders e-reader, where it was a great model. You'd drive your car to the Borders bookstore, if you could find one locally, and you'd walk into the store, and you'd walk to this thing called the book downloading station. And you'd take your e-reader, and you'd put it in the book downloading system, and then you'd type some things in, you download your book, and then you drive on home. Right? I mean, the system that it would get you books that they might not have stocked, but it completely defeated the purpose of online shopping. Right? This is an architecture that was designed for the 20th century, and it never caught up. And we can see what happened. You know, Borders in 2005 was a $4 billion business with 15,000 employees and stores around the world. And by 2011, it had to shut its doors. It never adapted. Same thing for Blockbuster, which, incidentally, the CEO of Netflix, when Netflix was on the rise, asked Blockbuster's CEO if they wanted to join forces. His response is, "We don't need you. We're Blockbuster." Yeah, good luck with that. So if you look, though, at the advantages that startup industries have, it's the same advantages that violent non-state actors enjoy. Startup industries are more nimble. They're able to adapt themselves to technology. And that's what violent non-state actors do. I think of them as startup actors in the political organizing space. And governments, of course, look a lot like legacy industries. So that's the fundamental problem, I think. What do we do about that? Well, one thing is I would depart slightly from Dave's comments, and that I do think we have a failure to learn. I think that in the analytic sphere, when you look at a number of diagnoses we've had over the course of the past 6 years, you've had a lot of error that has gone without reflection as to why it occurred. Go back to the New York Times You know, February 2011, as Arab regimes topple, Al-Qaeda watches history fly by. An article which displayed what the consensus was at the time, that Al-Qaeda was watching hopelessly, saying, oh no, these revolutions are happening, what do we do about it? We're not part of the revolutionary movements. Obviously, things didn't turn out that way. Right? In retrospect, the analytic line at the time looks kind of quaint, right? That people actually thought that you had massive regional upheaval and violent non-state actors wouldn't be able to capitalize, right? That you'd have a massive wave of stability as governments toppled with respect to sub-state violence. That's never happened in the history of the world, maybe, at least when you had pre-existing violent non-state actors. Obviously, when the Soviet bloc fell, things weren't necessarily destabilizing right away, although they were destabilizing, right? Chechnya and Kosovo and the Bosnian War, right? You had destabilization. Maybe it wasn't as fast as it was here, but it looks quaint. I think we do have a failure to learn. And we have a failure to act strategically in coordinated ways. I mean, those who have experience with government, working for government, working with government, know that there is something dysfunctional about the way things fit together. We're tactically brilliant. We have trouble making that tactical brilliance result in actual advances. One thing that I am a big advocate of is startups within government. You know, debureaucratizing discrete spaces. Maybe it's the messaging space. Maybe it's another space, but a certain space related to violent non-state actors with specific goals. That's something that big legacy industries have done successfully, creating startups within their own space with the kind of advantages that startups enjoy. I think we need to increasingly think about how to debureaucratize discrete spheres within government. But ultimately, organizational design is a fundamental challenge that we need to pay attention to. And I remember years ago, I had a friend, Ray. I used to, back before I had kids, I used to actually socialize with people. I remember those days.
I do too. We used to socialize.
We did.
Before you had kids.
We did, and now we don't. I had a friend, Ray, back when I used to socialize, and he'd go out with us, with me and other friends of mine, back when I had friends, when we were drinking. And he'd always come over, and he worked for a think tank. It's now gone out of business because nobody cares about organizational design. But he worked for a think tank that actually focused on organizational design. And he'd always come over and say, what are you guys talking about? And so many times I'd say, Ray, we're talking about organizational design. And his face would brighten and say, really? I'd say, no, of course not, right? Because nobody cares about organizational design. But actually, and it was really starting a business that made me realize this. There's no greater predictor of success. And that's the case in the economic sphere, and that's the case when it comes to combating violent non-state actors. If your organizational design is off, you're going to fail. And we see that happening again and again. So look, I'll leave it there because it's a much bigger challenge, but I think we have to understand what the challenge is from a policy perspective. It's not just having the right strategy or the right sets of policies chosen from a bullet pointed list or a menu. It's about the actual design of the entity that's trying to take action, in this case, the US government. And a fundamental thing that we need to do, my advice for any administration would be to understand that dysfunction in organizational design, and that should be at the very top of the priority list because that's where success is going to come from.
All right, you can key me there. Professor Fair is here. Now, she will win the award for coming the farthest since she just arrived from Bangladesh. So, but how many people out there took an Uber today? Okay. Have you ever had a flat tire in an Uber? Okay, so.
I've had two in 4 days.
So, please give Professor Fair some slack for coming all the way from Bangladesh and suffering through Uber. Of course, as you all know, she's a professor here in the Security Studies program, and she's an expert on South Asia with extensive field experience throughout the region. And I can tell you that from a personal perspective, when I want to know something about South Asia, I turn to Professor Fair, and I've had the opportunity to hear her lecture on numerous occasions, and I always learn so much. She is a prolific writer, has written numerous books, including her acclaimed book, Fighting to the End, The Pakistan Army Way of War. And of course, she speaks multiple languages, writes, reads, researches in multiple languages, and has extensive experience. So with that, I'm going to give you the floor for 20 minutes.
All right, thank you. Does one of my languages include profanity?
Yeah. That's the one that makes me blush.
Exactly. That's an inside joke, maybe. All right. So the nice thing about going to Bangladesh is that you never come back alone. So you always have this little gastrointestinal jihadist, you know, riding with you. So you gotta excuse me if I'm a bit whacked, because I am. So I study South Asia. So what we're going to do, I'm just going to do a little tour de farce throughout the region. And I'm going to begin with Afghanistan, and I'm going to end with Sri Lanka, probably not a country that is going to be discussed much in the context of violent extremism, but I think it's important that we keep our eye on that ball for a couple of reasons. So Afghanistan has a number of challenges. I mean, I don't need to state too obviously that we've been fighting this war since 2001, and we've been consistently losing it. The reasons for this, I think, fall into two baskets of deplorables. One is Pakistan and the ISI, right? So we have put ourselves in a situation of going to war with this one partner, which is particularly dedicated to undermining our efforts there. And the other basket of deplorables has to do with Afghan governance, right? We've systematically seen a failure of the Afghan government to get its act together and clean up corruption. So we have this superstructural problem, which is where we have a government that we've made that's really oversized. It's a deeply corrupt government, and it's really hard to fix a corrupt government and right-scale a corrupt government, which often means downscaling, while you're also trying to fight multiple insurgent campaigns, right? You fire some of these guys, you lay them off, where do they go? They go and join one of the multitude of the insurgent groups that are operating in the country. So within this superstructure of a disaster, we also have this emerging competition between the Taliban, AQIS, which David has already talked about at length. I don't need to go into further detail about what that is and why it is, but also ISIS. And the puzzle here is that what people may not appreciate is the Taliban, which is not a monolithic entity. I always use the example of a kaleidoscope, right? It's a little flecks of plastic. You give it a flick, it looks like one thing. Flick it again, you get a different picture. So the different commanders within this rubric are confederating, and those confederations are constantly changing. But what's happened with the demise of Mullah Omar, the controversy around his successor, Mullah Mansour, who, you know, drone be upon him, is no longer on this earth. He's gone to get his virgins or his raisins, depending upon the Quran version that you're using. And of course, with Osama bin Laden's demise, that alignment with the Taliban and AQIS began to fray. And some of those elements have taken the opportunity that ISIS has presented to join ISIS. So in other words, they're simply reflagging. But what's important to understand is that the Taliban are doing this because they're very frustrated with the way in which the ISI has tried to control them. So they probably hate the Pakistanis as much as they hate the Americans. Where ISIS in particular is most worrisome is in the Kandahar area. Now, I was also in Afghanistan earlier this fall, so I've had just a lot of vacation hotspots. You just vacationing in Herat, you just have no idea how lovely that is. But the Afghans have a really interesting theory, and when they first floated it a year ago, I was like, that's just typical, you know, no, I think there's no, this is nonsense. Now I'm coming to believe that the Afghans may be right. The Afghans are fervently of the belief that Pakistan's intelligence agency, the ISI, is actually behind ISIS. Now, you might think that's a bit crazy, but if you were to think about Pakistan's constant ability to keep riding a tiger and only lose a leg or two, it's like the Black Knight for those of you who are Monty Python enthusiasts, it's not a bad strategy, right, for the ISI to begin cultivating what appears to be a fairly serious competitor on a strategically important piece of geography with respect to Pakistan. So the more I keep looking at this puzzle, and I look at the way in which the Pakistanis are losing positive control over the Taliban, the more the incentive structure for Pakistan's intelligence agency to be doing this makes sense. And of course, the NDS, which is the Afghan intelligence agency, would be foolish if it weren't trying to do the same. So this leaves us, the Americans. What do we do about this fiasco, right? We are continuing to make we're continuing to have a troop presence, but I want to draw your attention to something that doesn't get a lot of attention, and that is the fiscal drawdown. And obviously, we have Trump Munbashi, and we don't know what he's doing because he's been too busy taking away health care and waging the war on women. We don't actually know what he's going to do with respect to South Asia. But if the magical, you know, sword slicing of budgets goes down and Afghanistan falls into that basket, we're going to be in a lot of trouble because it's not just the troops that matter in Afghanistan, it's also the money. And I think one of the most important lessons, and we talk about this in my South Asia security class, and that is Najibullah. Najibullah was able to hang on for 2.5 years after the last Soviet soldier crossed the Amu Darya. As soon as the last check was cashed, his government fell. And we have built a much larger rentier state in Afghanistan than the Soviets ever did. So the fiscal problem is much more discouraging than it ever was during the period of the Soviet occupation. The Afghan government has virtually no ability to raise revenue. It can't even pay for the recurring costs of its government. So while I think it's very easy in this town where we kind of let the military and military imperatives lead the questions and the answers about Afghanistan, we really need to be thinking about the economic sustainability. Because when President Ghani or whoever his successor is, when he's unable to pay the paychecks to the Afghan National Security Forces, all of those militias that we aggregated up to produce this corrupt ANSF are going to disaggregate, and they're going to go back to the militias from which we constituted them. And I think this is an incredibly pertinent issue that doesn't get the attention that we really need to be focusing on. This is going to allow me to go into Pakistan. Actually, I want to draw your attention to a piece I just wrote for War on the Rocks. Pakistan is not waging a war against terrorists. It is waging a war against the people who oppose terrorists. Over the summer, it passed a draconian cyber terrorism law. Now, if you follow Pakistani terrorist groups, as I do, you'll find them all over Twitter. They just love the Twitter. They just love the Facebook. And one of the things that you'll always find is that some Pakistani security professionals are actually protecting them. So this is in violation of 2 to 3 UN Security Council resolutions, one of which is actually Chapter 7, which says that Pakistan is supposed to be, in fact, all countries are supposed to be actively involved in preventing terrorist groups from operating on their soil. So this is just the obverse of that, right? Because they're actually deploying state resources to protect groups which are not only proscribed as foreign terrorist organizations by the United States, they're also proscribed by the United Nations Security Council. So this is incredibly disconcerting. As often happens when you get a new army chief in Pakistan, all the folks in the beltway are like, oh, can we do work with this guy? He looks like a straight shooter. I've been studying Pakistan long enough to know all the conversations. I don't have to be there. It's like that goldfish in the bowl. Oh, that's a new couch. That's a new couch, because the goldfish is too dumb to realize it's the same couch. So don't be a goldfish, all right? That's my message. Don't be a goldfish. So let's talk a little bit about the new army chief. Everyone thinks that, you know, some magical, you know, celestial orifice is going to produce a new kind of Pakistan army chief. It ain't happening. This guy is going to be worse than the previous guy. Why? And the previous guy was pretty damn bad. Why is that? Well, there were a bunch of rumors going around about this fellow that he was an MOD. Many Pakistanis, probably most, by most I mean 98%, believe that MIDs are actually wajibul qatl, liable to be killed. That's a really big deal. Anyone know any MIDs that are in Pakistan, do your best to get them out because it's open season on MIDs. So any idea that he was going to somehow be softer, gentler, whatever the fantasy was, should be completely torpedoed by this rumor, because he has to be more draconian than anyone else to prove that somehow he isn't tainted by having ties to these MIDs. And we've actually already seen that in action. What makes him quite interesting is that he has experience I don't know if you guys know what CPEC is. I call it Colonizing Pakistan to Enrich China. Its formal name is the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, but that just sounds too nice from my point of view. But it's anchored in the north of Pakistan, where the Gilgit-Baltistan area connects with Xinjiang. And the idea is that it would link Kashgar in Xinjiang with Pakistan's Gilgit-Baltistan in the north, and it would go through the south, and then it would come out to this port in Gwadar, which is in Pakistan's rest of Balochistan province, where Pakistan has also been, with our money and our weapons, waging what can only be called a genocide. But are we going to put Leahy on the Pakistan army? I doubt it, although we should. But this particular army chief has had experience at both of these poles of CPEC. So we're not going to expect him to be kinder and nicer. We're actually going to expect him to be more brutal, more willing to kill their own people to make these two geographies safe for Chinese exploitation. He's also spent quite a bit of time on the line of control vice the Indians, and he came in at a time of escalated conflict. The Indians kind of said, we're not taking it anymore. So after the Pakistanis dispatched Lashkar-e-Taiba to a military base in Uri, which was actually the largest number of peacetime fatalities, the Indians hammered back. So I expect with this army chief, we're actually going to see an ever greater embrace of these different jihadi assets that Pakistan has, and they have numerous. And I also expect that we're going to continue to see this draconian crackdown against civil society activists that would like to see a different kind of Pakistan. Unlike Afghanistan or Bangladesh or Sri Lanka, Pakistan has another problem, and that is that not only is it wedded to using jihadi assets as a tool of state power, it does so in conjunction with nuclear weapons. And one of the things that Pakistan has done is that it's invested in the tactical battlefield. Tactical nuclear weapons doesn't really make sense, right? You use a tactical nuclear weapon, all of a sudden you have strategic effects. It's a silly name. So we're going to call it battlefield nuclear weapons. Now, on the one hand, their doctrine is somewhat risible. Their actual doctrine, and you can't make this up, it's just like Wile E. Coyote, you know, blowing himself up, but that's Pakistan. So what is their doctrine? Well, they want to be East and West Germany. So let me explain briefly. If they see the Indians amassing and they feel that there's going to be a critical threat of the Indians crossing the border, and they're not making this up, this is for real, they are going to do an airburst of a tactical nuclear weapon on their own soil. Now, for those of you who know who, my PhD is in humanities, so I mean, I'm going to defer to other folk who are smarter than me, but I believe that's called an EMP blast, which will knock out their command and control. They're not deterred. Okay, if the Indians continue to amass, and that demonstration EMP blast didn't adequately scare the Indians, why should it? They're next going to use tactical nuclear weapons on their own population. So if I'm an Indian, I'm going to be making sure I don't cross the international border, say at the desert, I'm going to want to be crossing the border where I might cause the Pakistanis to cause themselves the most grief. If still the Indians cross, then they're going to use nuclear weapons on the Indians, which is ostensibly meant to trigger India's second response. So what is, I mean, do we really believe that the Pakistanis are going to nuke themselves? Of course not. But what I find very interesting in all the years I've been studying South Asia is that the Indians will constantly say, as they're calculating whether to respond to one terrorist outrage or another, but the Pakistanis have nuclear weapons. In all of the years I've been studying South Asia, I've never heard the Pakistanis say, but the Indians have nuclear weapons. So it is my understanding, having spent much of the summer in India, that this government is trying to find ways of, in fact, making the Pakistanis remember that India too has nuclear weapons. And you'll see the Indians talking about some fairly provocative things, for example, supporting the Baloch insurgents. I personally think it's a bad idea. The Baloch insurgents, they're disorganized. They tend to kill a lot of civilians. That will not redound to India's advantage. Some of the militant groups that are Islamists that India could think about partnering with, that also has the capacity for a lot of blowback. And the Indians so far don't have the ability to do targeted operations where, for example, they can put a sniper in place to kill someone like Hafiz Saeed. So the Indians right now don't have the capabilities to do anything that they want to do. But I have no reason to believe that that's going to deter India from trying to do something. So obviously, what's happening in Pakistan has a lot to do with what's happening in India. So I'm going to be very brief about India. What's actually puzzling is if you look at all of the things that have been said about India, and particularly its Hindu nationalist government in the last few years, you should expect India's Muslims should just be going crazy, right? They should be marching all over the place and demanding all sorts of changes. But India is actually the dog that doesn't bark. And I say that as a dog lover. I don't mean that in a bad way. Big fan of dogs, although I've recently had to like cats, apparently. So I know. I'm a dog lover. But in any event, so what is interesting about India is that India, if you look at the socioeconomic disparities between Muslims and everyone else, if you look at the Hindu nationalist government, if you look at some of the really provocative domestic political events that are happening, so for example, the Gai Rakshak movement, which is the cow protection movement, beating up and killing people because they're suspected of having beef in the refrigerator when it's actually goat, you'd expect India's Muslims to be much more riled up and mobilized than they've actually been. And so in some sense, all of us that think about this problem set, we're always chasing the problem. We don't actually spend a lot of time looking at places that should be a problem but isn't. And so I think for those of us that are interested in peace and conflict studies, India is a really puzzle waiting to be explored. There's so much variation within the different states of India. There's actually more variation between Indian states than between, say, India and Bangladesh. So for researchers, India is just a treasure trove of interesting sort of natural experiments that we should be exploiting. But there are a couple of problems with India. You don't see ISIS, or for that matter, AQIS, being able to conduct attacks in India itself. And again, that's another really good example of what we should be studying as something that's going right. But India has produced now perhaps in the order of several hundred individuals that are going to ISIS. And what again is puzzling is they're not coming from the traditional disenfranchised Muslim groups that you often hear about in India's north, particularly Kashmir. They're actually coming from some of India's most educated states that have the highest rankings in terms of human capital. So Kerala is churning out ISIS wannabes, perhaps notably relative to other states. And these are not individuals that you can call poor or what have you. They tend to follow the trend of terrorists in South Asia, which is they come from middle-class families. They tend to be very educated. The Indians have a different way of handling it than we do. So what happens in many cases is the parents call the security forces and say, you know, I think my kid has gone off the deep end. Please find him because we don't want him returned in a coffin from Syria. And the Indian security forces, they'll make an assessment about how dangerous this kid is. And if they assess that he's not dangerous, he'll actually return them to the family, because the Indian logic is if they put them into the criminal system, that they'll actually become more vigorous terrorists than if they put them back in the family and make sure that the family is charged with keeping an eye on this person. And so far, when I've spoken to Indian law enforcement, they seem very happy with the way this is working out. And I, you know, only time will tell if in fact that's a valid assessment. So let me turn very briefly to Bangladesh. As you move from Afghanistan to Pakistan to India to Bangladesh, all of these ideological lines that animate many of the terrorist groups that Daveed and I study, but you actually find by the time you get to Bangladesh, they're all terrorists. So all of the branding that Lashkar-e-Taiba does, the branding that AQIS, the branding that ISIS does very robustly in Pakistan and Afghanistan doesn't happen in Bangladesh. And so people don't even make this distinction. ISIS, AQIS, and in fact, many Bangladeshis don't even believe that these groups are even real. It took the attack on the Holy Bakery this summer to even convince the government of Bangladesh that they might actually have a problem with foreign terrorists. So one of the general themes of terrorism in Bangladesh that I think I can say with some certainty is that the older group of individuals that fought in Afghanistan, they were educated in madrasas, they were aligned with the old Deobandi groups, Harkatul Jihad Islam, Bangladesh, those fellows are still aligned with AQIS, and this is following the old arrangement with the Taliban
and Osama bin Laden. So the Deobandis and al-Qaeda have long been in partnership. But these newer terrorists that haven't come up through groups like Huji Bangladesh, they're going straight for ISIS. Now, this raises a puzzle about what is ISIS. And I've had some disagreement with my fellow analysts. For example, the Holy Bakery attack. If you look at the five pictures of the dudes that said, you know, Allahu Akbar, this is for ISIS, and their squiggle flag, if you looked at it very closely, they all had one gun. They took pictures. And it wasn't an AK-47. It was like an AK, you know, 22 and a half. I'm being facetious, because that's not a thing. But it basically is a thing. It's a trainer for an AK-47. It wasn't even a proper gun. And you know it was the same gun, because it had the same scratch marks, right? So, ISIS, they have the same pea shooter. They're sharing the same pea shooter. And most of the deaths that occurred in the Holy Bakery were actually due to small arms fire, like handguns, or, as is the case with Bangladeshi terrorists, with machetes. What's funny, and I don't mean funny in a ha-ha kind of way, if you actually look at the number of attacks that have taken place in Bangladesh, if you knew the number of attacks, you would be startled. But the victim yield of these attacks tend to be very low because Bangladeshi terrorists tend to have very low capabilities. The victim yield is actually one on average. So if we were to take the victim yield from a Pakistani attack and redo the math for Bangladesh with Bangladeshi attacks, you all would be freaking out. You wouldn't even believe that, you know, people would just go wandering around Bangladesh. It would look that dangerous and that scary. In 2005, to give you a sense of what they are logistically capable of doing, in 2005, they set off about 500 bomblets in 63 of 64 districts, all within the course of an hour. Now, that's pretty impressive in any country, but when you take into consideration that Bangladesh has more navigable rivers than roads, I want you to appreciate the logistical feat. So Bangladesh, I don't know how to describe it. Anyone who's been there will know what I'm talking about. There's just something not halal about the place. There's a lot of ambient political violence. There's a lot of support for these militant groups, but the militant groups themselves, so in that attack I just told you about, they killed three people, right? So you're just waiting as if for some competent terrorist trainer to kind of take these guys through the finishing school that's so readily available in Pakistan. So Bangladesh is, I don't know how to describe Bangladesh. It's a problem that keeps waiting to happen in a bigger way, but we somehow keep missing the big giant attack. So far, the Holy Bakery was the biggest, and the fatalities were, in the scheme of things, relatively low. But I will tell you a funny story about Bangladesh. So I just came back, as Dave said, and I met with the chief counterterrorism guru there. He gives me the briefing about, you know, all the terrorists in Bangladesh and what they're going to do about it. And this is when I thought, oh dear Lord, we are screwed. So they were showing us some of their CVE videos, and of course all this vernacular is imported from the United States and DFID, right? Because they want to get DFID in USAID programming. I think CVE is garbage, but you can get rich if you have an NGO where you can, you know, sell these CVE programs. In fact, we should be doing this, David. We should totally be rolling in the CVE dough.
Cash.
Right. So he shows me the video, and he's very proud of it. And there's no other way I can summarize this. There's boobs of Bangladesh. The video opens up. There's a woman on a beach in a bikini, in a tank top with no supporting garments. And then this young lady goes to fish. She goes to pick tea. She goes to frolic with the natives in the Chittagong Hill Track. It was so outrageous that I don't get embarrassed easily, but I was like, oh my God, I can't. I feel like soft porn. I couldn't watch. My senior colleague was with me, and I was looking at him. We couldn't make eye contact. And he asked us when the video was over, what do you think? We want to show that Bangladesh is a secular country. And I'm like, I'm not going to say anything. I'm just going to say that sometimes leading with this approach backfires. So that's what the crack counter-terrorist team in Bangladesh, this is how they're handling this, the boobs of Bangladesh. We are screwed. But let me end on a happy note. Sri Lanka. All right, so everyone knows that the LTTE, they're dead and gone, right? Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, they're gone. But are they really gone? So you've been following Sri Lanka. This was a government that waged war for peace, and Sri Lanka feels a little bit let down by the international community that they're one of the few countries that actually squashed a 35, 40-year insurgency, depending on when the clock starts ticking. So they want to be recognized for this brilliant strategy of eliminating the LTT. But what they haven't done is actually tried to build the peace. So in fact, they've done everything they can to undermine peace building. They have been adamant that they're not going to do anything that appeases the Tamils. They're continuing to move Sinhalese settlements into Tamil areas, or continuing to build cantonments. And so this raises a couple of questions. Will the LTTE really remain dormant? Or will it be like the Sikh insurgency, which was fought between the late 70s and the early 90s in India? And the Indians kind of did a similar thing. They just rounded up a bunch of dudes of military age and dispensed with them summarily. Well, that insurgency remains dead, except in the diaspora, where they nurture these illusions. So it's possible that what Sri Lanka experienced is going to be reminiscent of what we've seen in the Punjab. But it's also possible we're going to see what's happened with the Maoist insurgencies across India, that in fact there may be a recrudescence. But one of the things that has happened in the course of the last several years with the LTTE's demise is that we've had the emergence of Buddhist terrorism. So all of your friends that are Buddhists, that talk about the peaceful Buddhists and don't eat meat, bunch of rubbish. Just point to the meat-eating killers of Muslims and Christians and Hindus in Sri Lanka. So what has emerged in the wake of the LTTE's demise is a much more communally polarized country, and it's mobilized these other communities that had been affected through the insurgency. So where if you were a Sri Lankan Muslim, you were screwed by the LTTE, but you were also screwed by the Sinhalese. And so their answer has been to turn to communal politics. What we have, and then I'm going to shut up, what across the entire region in one way or another, we're also being affected by the Rohingya crisis. And this is the Rohingyas, by the way, Aung San Suu Kyi has always been opposed to the Rohingyas being Burmese or Myanmarese citizens. So this isn't new. It's just that I think people had higher expectations for her. And the violence against the Rohingyas have gone on through various phases. Back in 2005, I was in a Rohingya refugee camp in Bangladesh. Just, I want you to think about it, so bad. It's so bad in Burma or Myanmar that Rohingyas are fleeing to Bangladesh. Just think about that for a minute. And of course, Bangladesh doesn't want to take them either. It doesn't view them as citizens. So if you're looking at the different terrorist groups and their Twitter feeds and other social media feeds, like more dark jihadi feeds, what you'll find is that the Rohingyas, both in Myanmar, as well as in Bangladesh, are sitting ducks for not only groups like AQIS and ISIS, but also Lashkar-e-Taiba. And so thinking about Sri Lanka, as we see that Sri Lanka's complex Muslim communities being eaten at by these mainstream political forces, we also very well might expect to see Sri Lankan Muslims being pulled into this vortex as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Christine. That was quite a tour of South Asia. So, all right, Uda, please.
I would pivot very rapidly to Western Europe. Don't get whiplash. I'll start by arguing that there is no such thing as homegrown terrorism, and the concept should be retired immediately. The concept of homegrown terrorism misidentifies, misdescribes the nature of the problem that we are dealing with by suggesting that the root causes of the growth of Salafi jihadism in Western nations, Europe, as well as in Australia, United States, and Canada, lies at home. It does not. It also leads to poor policies that do not really direct attention on the very important factors that actually do drive this expansion that we have seen. The numbers have been mentioned. There's no need to replicate them, but estimates of Western European foreign fighters to Syria and Iraq now range from somewhere between 6,000 and 9,000. We don't know how many Americans have gone, but interestingly, it seems that we constantly find new folks who have managed to actually go there and join the caliphate. The more appropriate terminology is glocal. Glocal is sort of a fancy word in the sense that it's obviously a contraction of local and global. And but I think that is an accurate description of what we're dealing with in the sense that Salafi jihadism is always local in presentation. It exploits local complaints and local narratives, but invariably the practice and the aim of the Salafi jihadist movement is global. A striking aspect of ISIS's recruitment strategy is that the same methods have been used with minimal adaptation in terms of language, but also adaptation in terms of sort of picking up on what's local issues, to recruit volunteers from Europe and North America, from Asia and Africa, and even Latin America. Al-Qaeda's previous incarnation, not the one we are dealing with in the near future, but previous incarnations of Al-Qaeda has manifested itself as an alliance of various national organizations, AQAP, Al-Qaeda in Islamic Maghreb, et cetera, et cetera. The caliphate, in contrast, has been a sausage factory. You put people in from different nationality and you spew them out and they are all just jihadists. That's not just perhaps a little bit of an exaggeration because fighter brigades in the caliphate have been organized along languages. So one of the key problems behind the key drivers of the so-called Franco-Belgian network that has been was responsible for the November 2005 attack in Paris and the March 2006 attack in Brussels was that many the core actors here all served together in a Francophone fighter brigade in Syria. I'll show you some pictures. If you'd put it up, please, the first. That comes from my research. I have, for the past 10 years, laboriously been coding information about the demographics of Westerners who have or known to have either been declared international terrorists, have died, or have been convicted in connection with Al-Qaeda and its affiliated and successor organizations such as ISIS. And in this, what you're watching here is that we also code their interpersonal relationships. This is a massive task. And at this point in time, I have 6,000 individuals coded in this database and 20,000 personal relationships and relationships between individuals and organizations. When I started the work, I thought I could do this. I would maybe end up with 750 people. So that shows you how I was right about this being important and the need for a new methodology for analyzing a problem. I was completely off with respect to the scale of how this this phenomenon has evolved over the last 10 years. And it would be no surprise to you that I think this picture here that you have that is centered of the interpersonal networks and the connections to the people who perpetrated the November 2005 attacks in Paris, that's one blob. It was actually, as you know, several separate incidents, as well as the March 2016 bombings in Brussels. I don't believe that this network is yet fully coded, but the bottom line is that this was a very dense and thick network that produced this wave of attacks that we have seen. The use of a social network analysis was, for some period of time, considered the great solution to figuring out who's who and what to do in counterterrorism, and then it sort of dropped off our attention span, in part because it's a very iffy methodology to use, because the old statistical instructor admonition, garbage in, garbage out, certainly applies. in practice and using real social data, everyone at these networks that we can draw using this methodology is what I would call a fuzzy network. Essentially, the analyst, the researcher decides who's in and who's out in what you are graphing. And in this case, I should speak a little bit about methodology, even though I don't know how many of you care for it. But we started in this case with taking the perpetrators of these attacks, and then we simply threw up on the screen all their first-person contacts and degrees. And I'll give you the statistics for this network later, but that produced a network that is close to 400 people with an inner network of over 80 people who at this point in time are known to have either died or been arrested in connection with this terrorist campaign. The thing that is truly dispiriting about this is that actually European officials knew that the network was being formed and knew that it was being infiltrated back into Europe, and yet proved unable to stop it. I will argue that there are some unseen successes in this network. A good number of the people who were being infiltrated actually never made it to Paris in November. And I have, after having been studying this network for some time, arrived at the conclusion that Abba Oud, the guy on the ground, actually ended up being short of a couple of suicide bombers, and ultimately that ended up being the reason that his plans to go and set off a couple of suicide bombs in the financial district known as Le Défense did not happen. He instead recruited his female cousin to help him out, and she was so happy and proud of it that she spilled the beans to her girlfriend who went to the police, which apparently is the only reason that we ended up with a shootout in Saint-Denis that prevented the attack. Now, this graph does show both successful and failed and foiled incidents following Bruce's recommendation that in order to get a structural picture of what we're dealing with, we need to recognize that the margin between a successful and a failed or a foiled violent attack is a narrow one, and often a matter of happenstance. Now, Moore will argue that if you start thinking about networks in this way and thinking more closely about the social organization of networks, this type of analysis can actually help us uncover some of the structural strengths and the structural drivers of network growth and how we have ended up in the situation that we are in today. We have focused in counterterrorism policy very much on the decapitation of leaders, killing the leaders, putting them in prison, and then at the CVE and the sort of very low retail level. I am no more of a enthusiastic about our efforts in that regard than Christine is, but what is missing in this picture is a concerted effort to actually target the social organization of networks, which is not something that happens overnight. The network that you see there was constructed over a period of time that goes back at least to 2013, but at its root actually goes back to people who were Frenchmen who worked with Musab al-Zarqawi in al-Qaeda in Iraq. One of the members is a man named Peter Sharif, who has been ambidextrous. He's an Afro-Caribbean French militant. His mother is also involved. Mamie Jihad is her memorable label. But Peter Sharif was already was radicalized in the 19s and went to Iraq in 2004. He ended up in fighting in Fallujah, getting captured by Americans, put in Camp Booker, then went up to Abu Ghraib, where he was freed in a prison break staged by the AQI's successor organization. He then was arrested in Syria, ended up back in France, where he was briefly put in prison, but was released pending trial, best as I can work out, and then actually ran away and went to Yemen, where he went to work for AQAP and became the handler for one of the Kouachi brothers who was responsible for the Charlie Hebdo attack. Now, here you have, in this very short anecdote of one man, you have a captured picture of how networks built. If you have a jihadist in your neighborhood, count on the fact that he or she will want not just one friend, many friends. Here are the core statistics of the network. You will notice that one of the interesting aspects of this network is that we are dealing with a large number of Moroccans, people of ethnic Moroccans. This is a stark contrast to, say, Al-Qaeda before 2001, when bin Laden built his organization out of taking over former militants living in Europe from the GIA and then renamed as GSPC. At that time, before 2000, through the Millennium Attack, basically Algerians manned Al-Qaeda operations in Europe at that time. Today, we have seen a real shift in the demographics of these networks. This is also a stark contrast to, say, the 2005 to 2007 homegrown terrorism wave that was populated by British Pakistanis who have been present in the contemporary networks, but have not been nearly as prominent as one might have suspected. And there are actually structural reasons for that. And one of the key reasons is that networks are organized in real life, not online. They are supported by online activities, but the social organization of the really dangerous networks happens on the ground. And let me show you another picture. One of the important aspects of this network that's also highlights what I said about the end of homegrown terrorism is that actually the network involved a fairly large number of non-Western citizens. So we have Pakistanis commanding ISIS troops in Libya. We have Britons and Frenchmen executing Iraqis and Syrians in their hometowns, and we also have Syrian and Iraqis blowing themselves up on the street of Paris. Muhlenbeck has, I think deservedly, and Brussels, the district in central Brussels that was home to some of the key people in this network carrying out the attacks in Brussels and in Paris, and actually they were capable of operating right out of the a network of homes in the area. I think there's been a lot of deserved focus on that, but what I did here in this map is that I also code where the last known residents of these individuals were that we know before they joined the movement, so to say. So this is what I call hometowns. If I don't have information about that, I instead code where they were first arrested. And coding this information for the Franco-Belgian network responsible for those key attacks that I threw up in the first graph leads to this picture. And clearly, as it's apparent from this, maybe Brussels have not deserved all of the criticism that has been heaped on the city. The reality is that a lot of people have been converging on Brussels for a long period of time because of Belgium's well-known enforcement failures. And that some of the people who were involved in this network were actually Frenchmen who years ago had moved to Brussels because they could, it was easier for them to escape surveillance and the oversight of the French security agency there. Now, so let me just briefly talk about this map. It was said by Rob Wainwright in February 2016, the director of Europol, and I quote, there are no concrete indication that terrorists are systematically using the stream of refugees to come into Europe undetected. Well, he probably would want to eat those words today. The human smuggling routes in the Mediterranean loop are all represented in this network. Greece, Italy, Spain, et cetera. Every one of those entry points were at some point in time used by the people in this network. This points to the geopolitical challenge that Europe faces today. We have seen dramatic increase in the monitoring of people traveling through airports. We have the predictable displacement effect of seeing terrorists moving by land and by sea instead. One of the most important aspects to European security coming from the jihadist and at his new border is that Europe is now facing the threat from this integrated Mediterranean loop that stretches all the way from Spain across the North African coastline to southern Italy and then again all around to the entry points in southern Turkey, going up into Greece, etc. There is some very bad news in this picture, and I would argue that this should make everybody worry greatly about the Balkans. We have talked about Turkey, but I will, just thinking structurally going forward, I would argue that the Balkans are in grave danger of becoming a gray zone. The Balkans have had one of the highest concentrations of foreign fighters per capita. And if you sort of did a back of the envelope calculation based on age and male population, and arrived at a number that said something about one out of every 1,000 males in the age group that we are concerned about between 18 and sort of 35, it may actually have traveled. That is both a high and a low number, depending on how you want to argue the point. But there are a number of issues with this. Hundreds of foreign fighters are second generation Bosnians and Albanians from Europe have also traveled. And many of the fighters from the Balkans have actually, at some point in time, also been to Europe. And typically, many of them carry passports from Europe. Some of the Balkan countries now also have visa-free access to the Schengen, through the Schengen arrangement. There are a number of reasons on the ground to be extremely concerned about the Balkans. One is that what we call the black flag villages. The religious composition of Bosnia-Herzegovina today is very different from what it was in the late 1990s. There has been a very concerted effort on the part of Saudis and Salafists to invest in the area and to convert Bosniaks into Salafists. There's also been a big migration, relocation. Local Bosnian newspapers over the summer were up in arms about reports that about 108 companies have acted as intermediaries for Kuwait and other Arab funders to buying up deserted villages in Bosnia-Herzegovina, where these villages have become settlements for Salafist communes, and some of them were found, came to the attention of local newspapers, because they started flying the flag of ISIS. A number of well-known recruiters have come from these villages. Hussein Bosniak is one of them. He was recently convicted on charges of recruiting for ISIS. Another one is Nusrat Imamovic, and both of these men are very important key figures, in part because they all fought with the jihadist brigade set up by Ayman al-Zawahiri in the civil war in the 1990s. A unit created in 1993 that was comprised primarily of Arab foreign fighters who were relocated by bin Laden to Bosnia. So this again illustrates the importance of the historical depth of these networks, something that I believe has been systematically underestimated as a driver of the expansion of the networks over the years. There's also the returnees. In November, some 20 people were arrested in connection with a plot to attack a world a quarterfinal in the Euro Cup that had the Israeli team play in Kosovo. The game was moved to another location. That plot was directed allegedly by a key Albanian cadre with the Islamic State. And finally, we are watching a convergence between smuggling networks and the jihadist networks. This is something that Al-Qaeda, particularly Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb, has done for years, getting involved in smuggling of cigarettes, but also human smuggling in networks that stretch all the way from West Africa to Finland. Reports in the Bosnian press have been that ISIS actually bought the mafia out of one of the Albanian drug operations. This is not something I can independently verify, so I'm basing this basically just on what I read in the newspapers. But we have seen jihadists use Bosnian, use old Yugoslav machine guns in Europe. The Albanian networks have produced false passports, false papers for the jihadists. So there are a number of good reasons to be concerned about Bosnia. Plus, we should also add that Russia has, for a long period of time, been investing in sowing dissent between Muslims and Slavs in the area, arguing that Europe is coddling the bad Muslims and the poor Slavs are not being adequately served. And most recently, over the summer again, there was a plot discussed about to break up Bosnia-Herzegovina. Now, I don't think we should dismiss these reports because this is, in fact, how Russia has been operating in Crimea, in the Baltics. And so there are good reasons to think that when it comes to the Baltics, the general strategic interest of the jihadist networks and that of Russia to undermine Europe at this particular area actually work in the same direction. So three outcomes present themselves for the Balkans, one of which has already been realized, namely that local fighters will return to the area and reinforce and cause problems for the very fragmented authorities in the area. Another option is that the area becomes a place where the Islamic State will resettle its the families, the women and the children that they haven't used as suicide bombers in Iraq yet. It is worth noting here that it appears to me that ISIS has very deliberately moved the foreign fighters out to other locations, and the foreign fighters are actually not taking the brunt of the fighting right now. I could be wrong about that, but I don't see a very high level of a kill ratio, so to say. The death toll of the foreign fighters appear to be lower than what we might assume. So I would say that this is a very high probability. And then finally, I would say that the more scary example would be that if it turned into an actual area war zone, which I do not actually think would be in Al-Qaeda's interest per se, but these things are not always predictable. So I want to conclude. I got a little note from our manager, and I want to direct your attention to this picture. It was taken, best as I know, and again, this is not something I can verify, I took it off Twitter, and not everything that's on Twitter is true. But this is from 2013. It's the photo dates from a time when ISIS fighters very freely posted photos of themselves on the Twitter feed. The photo is allegedly from Aleppo, taken in a house that had been taken over by a Franco-Belgian fighter group. And many of the people sitting in that room, we have been able to identify, and they subsequently have moved on to become very important people in the attack network that I showed you earlier. Now, so I will make a couple of inferences from this and a couple of recommendations. One inference is that networks are a kind of perverse social capital, that the way terrorist networks grow is by exploiting the ability to have people meet. The single most important predictor for when somebody becomes a terrorist is that that person knows a terrorist. That leads me to a prediction. We are in very bad shape in Europe because there are many more terrorists around, 10 times as many as there were around the time of when bin Laden's organization was as its strongest. The second is that if complex contagion of the kind that I described reinforce social bonds connected with living experiences that are formed in the ground and reinforced online are the way that social networks grow, we need to change public policy CT perspectives to focus on the midterm, not just on the entry level or the top leaders, but we need very aggressively to move to destroy this type of social capital and its ability to grow and expand. That does include shutting these types of activities down on the internet. But that has really already happened, and it may be counterproductive to go much further in that regard. That takes us back to very complicated and difficult police work. And that has to be police work that has to be integrated directly with information that's gained from the international arena. It is no good that somebody can filter back and settle in Belgium instead of France, as have been the experience in the past. Or maybe in Finland or in Sweden rather than in Germany. There has to be a very different approach to containing this population. It is notable that very few lawsuits have been brought in Europe against people who we know have committed crimes against humanity in Syria and Iraq. It hasn't even been tried. It is a crime to join a designated international terrorist organization. Yet, there has been very little effort to actually truly contain this population. Now, where this takes us in terms of Al-Qaeda versus ISIS is a discussion for another moment and for another day. I tend to take Bruce's view of this. ISIS, I have stressed in my presentation here that many of these folks that we are dealing with have proven actually be quite flexible in their allegiances. I have no reason, I see no reason why low-level and mid-level fighters will not be completely happy to migrate back to Al-Qaeda-directed networks, should that happen. But I also do not think that we should think of ISIS as sort of the end of ISIS when ISIS and the caliphate no longer exist. ISIS is still active in many of the same places where Al-Qaeda is active, as in Libya. And Al-Qaeda has been very noticeable, reluctant to actually confront ISIS. So I suspect that in the medium term, 2 to 3 years, perspective, we will see instead a sort of gradual takeover of all of these troops that have been aroused by ISIS. I'm sorry, this is a very pessimistic picture, sort of in the sky is falling group that we saw earlier this morning. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. I don't think anybody has presented an optimistic picture yet. So, but maybe Diego can. but I'm not optimistic on that either. So, Diego, over to you.
Right. Okay. Well, I want to start by thanking the organizers, both Bruce and David, the invitation and this a terrific event. I'm not as grateful because I was given the task of summarizing what 28 member states plus the supranational institution they form are facing in terms of current threats, challenges, what needs to be done, and what the Trump administration should learn from what's going on in Europe. And I'll try to do that in 20 minutes. So while I was thinking how to organize this, and I'll start with something easy because I know I'm the last speaker and it's been a long day, I want to show you a map of terrorist attacks in Europe since the 1970s. And don't worry, I'm not going to give you a historical overview. I'm not a historian as my colleagues. I'm a political scientist. I simply want to show that Europe has had considerable experience of both terrorism and counterterrorism. Okay? I will focus on what has been happening in the last few years, and I will be focusing particularly on ISIS and ISIS-inspired terrorism. But I'm showing you that picture not only to justify my use of PowerPoint, knowing that the chair is against using this tool, but also to make the point that counterterrorism is path-dependent. And by path-dependent, I mean that where we want to go depends on where we've been in the past. And I will try to summarize what EU member states are doing by trying to extract lessons from the European experience or from what each one of these countries has experienced in the past. Now, don't be scared about the concepts yet. What I want to do in the presentation, I want to separate these two blocks. First, I want to talk about the political economy of terrorism. And by these, I will not engage in sort of hardcore rationalist explanations or game theory. My approach is going to be much gentler. You're going to see that in a minute. And this, I found, was the best way of organizing what EU member states are doing. And then I will summarize these trends and challenges into what's being done at EU level and currently at the local level, where both these approaches, supply and demand, are being integrated. And I think this is the noble thing that is being done at EU level, and this is a lesson or something that other administrations or other countries can learn from. So the political economy of terrorism. My approach here would be that we should, or we can, understand terrorism as an industry, not as a market. I'm not trying to argue here that there's a supply curve and a demand curve, and where they cross each other, we have a point of equilibrium where price and the sort of quantity of terrorism is produced. Simply what I'm trying to argue is that terrorism can be seen as an industry, as a firm, as an organization, with goals, with objectives that wants to maximize its impact with minimal cost, and this organization that is constrained by social and political and economic realities. If we think this metaphor is useful, in this metaphor, supply would refer to the number of individuals who are willing to join an organization and commit violent acts in exchange for some sort of compensation here or in the afterlife. And demand would refer to what's the social support within a given community or group of sympathizers for political violence or terrorism as both a legitimate and necessary tactic to improve social reality. Because after all, those using political violence also think or also want to sort of improve their sort of immediate social landscape. Now, from the point of view of what's being done in Europe, most of what is being analyzed and implemented at policy level focuses on the supply side. This is what we've been talking about today, CT, and I guess is much of what we're going to be talking about tomorrow. We see here and read a lot more about individual terrorists and the supply side than the demand side. We know where they're coming from, what the religion is, what the age group, demographics, country, and so on and so forth. The expectation is that if we build a large enough database, we can start identifying patterns and profiles, and we can fine-tune the counterterrorist tools that are currently being used. But the European experience is that the number of explanatory variables or motivations or drivers of radicalization and political violence are too great, are too large to simply be modeled in a parsimonious explanation. So this is currently what is being done at the EU level. There's a lot of effort in terms of analysis on who they are. Different sort of estimates have been presented here. I'm using the ICSR, sort of King's College London data on the number of foreign fighters. They have sort of good evidence for 5,000 individuals. There's also research on returnees. The expectation is some of those foreign fighters coming from Western Europe will eventually return, and estimates of those who might be willing to commit an attack range from 1 in 5 to 1 in 10. There's also research on demographics and analysis of whether second and third generation migrants are more likely to engage in political violence than their parents. And recently, there's a lot of research on the crime-terror network, a nexus, because several of the attackers of, for example, the Paris and the Berlin attacks were known to the police. In the case of Germany, up to 50% of jihadists had criminal records and were known to the police for minor crimes, but they were known to the police. There's also research and effort being carried out on the spaces of radicalization, and you mentioned to this before, whereas the mosque was very important 10 years ago. Now the internet, and particularly that part of the internet we don't see and we cannot access through a Google search, the deep web, seems to be taking a lot of effort and resources from both police and intelligence agencies. And finally, how do they radicalize? And again, here, the last point I think is very important. I have several Moroccan friends, and they also tell me that it is the network of friends more than the family or the charismatic individual that, for example, in the case of Morocco, has extracted large numbers of young men to travel to foreign lands to fight. Within this supply side, what I would summarize is that part of the EU effort is encapsulated or is driven by this concept of radicalization, which is socialization of socialization which manifests itself in terrorism. Now, people say that this is a bit of a buzzword, that the radicalization might have been exhausted. People who say these are people who have also benefited from this agenda for a large number of years. And what police and what scholars, where they all disagree on what radicalization is, the only point of agreement is that radicalization is a process that ends in violent extremism. And police forces are now being asked to prevent attacks because they are told that there's a large number of explanatory variables that account for radicalization. They're looking for signs of radicalization in the appearance of men, on whether they're using the telephone or not, whether they are becoming discreet or not. But there's certainly no agreement, and it's very difficult to stop terrorists before they actually commit an attack. So there's, as you would expect, a partial failure. This has led agencies to demand more resources and increasing coordination both within state and across EU member states, right? So this is not much of a surprise, but we could look at this differently from the demand side, right? So if radicalization is conceptualized somehow differently, and we think the terrorists are just the apex of a pyramid with larger numbers of activists, of supporters, and sympathizers, then our understanding of radicalization would logically lead us to rethink the approach that authorities have to devise to prevent acts of terrorism. So from the demand side, and I think there were several questions with the keynote speaker that pointed in this direction, the demand side of terrorism is driven by grievances, both real and perceived. I'm not going to get into this, and I'm sure we can find a variety of examples. The point is that even if ISIS is an organization that can be contained or even defeated, the ideas that ISIS mobilize are very powerful. The idea of the caliphate as a project, as a political project that can unify Muslims across nations and across artificial borders is a powerful one. And again, the European experience is relevant here because both in the case of the IRA and the ETA, these two groups managed to sustain long-term campaigns of political violence because their message resonated with their supporters. And it was only when both the British and the Spanish state understood what the nature of the grievances were that they were able to fine-tune the instruments they used and they were able to defeat these two groups. So the point I'm trying to make now is that more should be done to tackle the demand side and not only the supply side, or what Citi is essentially trying to do. The demand side, and this has been mentioned already before, would involve things such as CVE strategies, counter-narratives, which I know the Dutch, for example, are thinking about. I know that the EU counter-terrorist coordinator is also thinking about, but it's a strategy with no content at the moment. And de-radicalization initiatives, because if we think that the number of foreign fighters ranges between 5,000 and 10,000, some of them will come home eventually, they will return. One has to devise strategies and design policies to reintegrate them into society. Because supporters for violent extremism are not homogeneously distributed across EU member states, and they are located within particular neighborhoods, within particular cities or areas, one needs to devise targeted approaches. Okay? One, and I think EU member states are realizing this, one cannot devise national strategies or state strategies and hope to broadcast the same message throughout their societies and not only arrest or neutralize terrorists, but also to prevent radicalization and the spread of ideas. So what I'm trying to argue is that both supply and demand approaches are necessary, that the traditional approaches that we have been focusing all day, both internal and external security, are necessary, but that they need to be complemented by demand side. And at this point, you would be justified to think, but here comes again the scholar, the academic that knows nothing about the practical world, wishful thinking, wanting practitioners not to be practitioners, but analysts. And you would be wrong, because this is actually what's being done in Europe at the moment, a combination of both supply and demand side. As you know, since the Madrid attacks, the majority of Al-Qaeda and ISIS-inspired attacks have focused on European cities. There's a good reason for this. Cities are seen as symbols of financial, economic, political power, but also because the overwhelming majority of European populations live in urban centers. So it's, if one wants to inflict damage, then these are the ideal targets. What cities are doing now is that they are invoking the principle of subsidiarity. The principle of subsidiarity is enshrined in the Treaty of Rome, which is the founding treaty of the European Economic Communities, and essentially means that the level of administration that is most affected by an issue should be responsible, should tackle that issue. And that's what cities want to do now. They want to have powers devolve to this lower level to be able to tackle an issue of security that affects their citizens. Now, we have a few interesting examples of policy experimentation, as you were mentioning at the beginning. Experiments are everywhere in the social sciences, but also in public policy. And some of these cities have implemented their own local action plans, which combine both supply and demand sort of issues. And we know that this is going to go forward. We know that much of the counter-terrorist effort and the prevention effort at EU level will take place at city level, because the EU network of experts of European Commission, the RAN network, has issued a couple of reports saying that this is one of the ways forward. Right? And now I'm very much aware that this is different to the challenges that the US may be facing, but I know that this is happening in Boston and other American cities that are implementing local action plans, and this may be helpful in other parts of the world. And what are these local action plans or local initiatives? What do they look like? Well, to start with, they are mainly focusing on radicalization, on the demand side. And they want to create sort of areas of coordination, multi-agency structures, where not only the police, but social services, education, health, civil society organizations, communities are able to talk to each other and recognize when there may be an issue with radicalization, which may not need the intervention of the police. This may be something that may be able to be dealt by the family, by the high school, and by social services. It's also a structure, not only horizontal, where all these departments are coordinated at city level, but vertical, because at city level, if one wants to prevent radicalization and improve the security of its citizens, cities also need to be aware of what's happening at the regional level and at the state level. So there's also vertical organization, and there's a sort of a two-way dialogue. And what's interesting about these sort of city approaches is that they overcome this false dilemma between supply and demand side, soft versus hard approaches. It is in cities where these two can be combined, and where the issue is not so much to decide one or the other, but how much of a soft approach and how much of a hard approach. At the moment, we have very few experiences of these. We have few practices, we have few examples, and what the EU coordinator is trying to do at the moment is to devise blueprints and local actions plans that could be implemented in a variety of settings, because large capital cities may have the resources to organize these and to train their officials and police officers, but there are many other sort of smaller towns that are not able to produce this. These local initiatives and the idea of combining both supply and demand side sort of makes us question some of our assumptions and brings interesting questions such as, what makes a resilient city and a resilient society? Why are there so many foreign fighters in Europe and not in the US? Is it because of its distance to the Middle East? Is it because agencies here in the US are more effective? Perhaps is it because of how each one of these two societies, assuming that Europe is a society, deal with its own immigrants? There are interesting questions there to be answered. The point is that, and I think some of the sort of the questions this morning went in this line, unless the more traditional approaches are combined with these CVA approaches, counter-narrative approaches, and initiatives of de-radicalization, it will be impossible to stop this current wave of religious terrorism, whether it's fourth or fifth. It's a matter of discussion. And it will be not possible for the EU to resist and combat the large number of foreign fighters that will eventually return if ISIS is eventually defeated and sort of taken territory from them. The other interesting aspect of this combination of supply and demand is that this shouldn't be seen as a response to ISIS-inspired terrorism, not at all. In fact, what I would like to argue, and part of the argument here is not to criminalize a particular or sort of stigmatize a particular religion or population, is that both supply and demand approaches is the ideal combination to fight with all sorts of radicalization and violent extremism. So these would apply to far-right extremism, to anarchism that is still, in case you don't know, still big in parts of Europe, in my hometown, for example. And with this, I want to conclude. How am I doing with time?
Good.
Yeah? Okay, so when I thought, what should the new administration know, or what should the audience take home? Well, the first one would be to take note of this incipient movement from state approaches to regional and local approaches, to city approaches, which is essentially a multi-stakeholder, or if you want, a system where there is horizontal coordination between all departments, plus vertical coordination, so that is local level, regional level, state level. Then the second concept that I would like you to take home is this idea of the political economy of terrorism, which is a bit pompous, I am aware, but the idea that most of what we discuss when we're talking about terrorism focuses on the supply side, very little on the demand side, and that the combination of the two is essential. In part, this realization comes from a different understanding of radicalization. We think that radicalization is something that affects individuals only. It's only something that happens at micro level, and this is a progression. Well, then CT might be enough. But if we think that radicalization takes place at the individual level, but also organizational level in social milieus, radical milieus, and also at state or systemic level, if that's our understanding of radicalization, well, then counter-radicalization needs to change. Huh? And CVE and CT also needs to change. And finally, once again, the idea that a comprehensive strategy, which was mentioned by the keynote speaker, needs to combine the traditional approaches with these sort of demand-side approaches, and that the community engagement, the engagement of communities from where these individuals come from and where the sympathizers and people who sort of agree with the goals but not with the means, this collaboration and the de-radicalization of violent extremists need to be long-term goals. Difficult to come up with sort of easy proposal for the near future, but certainly these have to be up there in the agenda. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. You didn't disappoint us. All right, well, now we have time for questions. I know that we've had four great presentations that really cover, you know, showed us that there's a lot more problems out there than just ISIS and Al-Qaeda, although most all related to them in some form or another. So, questions. Okay, in the back right here.
Antonia Ward on the St. Andrews Georgetown Exchange. So in terms of the discussion of the complex European terror networks, what impact do you think that the intended hard Brexit will have upon this and on collaboration in Europe as a whole in countering terrorism?
Would anybody like to talk about Brexit? Maybe somebody from Europe?
I'm very pessimistic about the situation. I find that this is happening at a time when the need for changing the governance structures within Europe on issues of CT are just extraordinary. As it's been said again and again, the capacity, policing capacity, the ability to integrate missions abroad with local police operations, even the nature of what it means to do local policing has dramatically changed. Most of what Diego described is that's coming out in the form of advisory programs or not mandatory programs. And it's a bit like, you know, I noticed you had my hometown Aarhus up on your PowerPoint. Now, let's be clear. Aarhus had a particular problem with a particular mosque, and all of the folks who left were teenagers who had gone to a particular youth group in that mosque. So afterwards, you set up a big program that's organized along, it then becomes a template for everybody else. Now, once those 20-some people had left from that mosque, it's not clear there was anybody else left in town who wanted to go to and join the Islamic State. So how are we going to measure the efficiency of that program? I think it's extremely wasteful. And as I argued, I think it's focusing on the wrong issue. The real issue should have been that that particular mosque should actually have been shut down a long time ago. So I think the loss of Brexit and the loss of the input within Europe of the British know-how and experience is a serious problem.
Diego?
Right. So the question was on the impact of Brexit on foreign fighters. Was that it? Well, the UK, together with France and Germany, being the largest states, are still today the countries that are sending more foreign fighters. Sort of in absolute numbers, we know that per capita or if you're in sort of percentage, Belgium is truly the one that is leading. With regards to what the impact is going to be on intelligence and CT, I'm not really sure, but May seems to be convinced that the participation of the UK in other networks of intelligence is one of the cards that they will use in the negotiation in order to get favorable terms with Europe. So it seems to me that the UK government is convinced that the sort of security aspect is well covered and that Brexit is not going to affect that negatively.
Questions? Okay, in the back here. Okay, next one here.
Tim Wilson, St. Andrews. I was going to take the bait offered by Jutta's comment that the Balkans was the weak flank for coming Salafist terrorism. And I just wondered if you could perhaps expand on that a little, given how striking it is in the 1990s, I'm thinking now of the work of Gilles Kepel and so forth, that yes, hardline Al-Qaeda type fighters made some contribution to that war, but they weren't particularly popular with Bosnian Muslim society at all. And as for Kosovo, which is a sort of much underrated example of political violence, how many other insurgencies can we think of that successfully managed to secede in Western Europe in the late 20th century? Admittedly, by borrowing NATO as their own private air force, but all the same. how extraordinarily free of sort of Islamist rhetoric that conflict was, despite Serb nationalist attempts to portray it so. So running with your suggestive and provocative hint, what's changed?
So one thing that has changed is that it has been one of the through travel routes. The area has been one of the true travel routes for sending fighters. There has been some, the traffic has been back and forth, and there has been a lot of young people have moved elsewhere but have maintained their connections. So one key issue is that there is an integration of the whole area within a much broader territory. The borders have been taken down. There's no border controls anymore to speak of. Yet we have authority structures where, so Bosnia and Herzegovina is a federal unit, but a police force in one unit can't actually freely go enter into the other unit without permission. So there's been a tremendous fragmentation at the local level. That fragmentation was set up by the peace agreement, but it has now is now seriously out of step with the social realities on the ground of people constantly moving back and forth. The other thing that has changed is the settlement of all of these Salafist villages. These are basically areas that have been depopulated and have been taken over and been resettled. Now, how seriously we should take that as a threat, I don't know. Some of these villages are just Salafist. They're not Salafi jihadists, but many of them are Salafi jihadists. And we have seen a large number of, religious mix is very different today. It's basically in terms of the makeup of the Muslim population in the area, we are now talking about Salafist, the state-sponsored moderate Islam of Cedric, a good number of people who were more Sufi-oriented, and there's no center that can hold. Population and the authority structures that were in place and really marginalized the Arab fighters in the civil war, which is, as you say, the conventional wisdom. They're no longer a political force. They're no longer, they are, some of them have moved into government positions. But the social dynamic is very different today, as is the geopolitical aspect. So I would argue those are the main reasons that I'm concerned.
And I think Marika in the center. I can't see.
Hi, Marika with SSP. My question is somewhat similar, actually, to what he said. I have a deep interest in Southeast Europe networks and foreign fighters. And as you are aware, currently there's a political struggle as well as a regional security that is quite unsettling, and particularly in Kosovo and Bosnia-Herzegovina. I guess my question is that the past 8 years has been a shift from Southeast Europe, so the sense of like Balkan fatigue. And what are some short-term and or long-term strategies do you suggest for like EU and as well as US policymakers in regards to these concerning issues in the region?
It is to beef up the police force and try to, as we have been discussing earlier, to create a stronger regional presence and increase enforcement structures. We could also, of course, argue that, maybe there should be more jobs, but I don't really think that's going to fix the situation within a reasonable time frame for what we are looking for. There's no evidence whatsoever, though, that the young men who have joined ISIS from the Balkans are among the poorest and come from really disadvantaged groups within in Kosovo or in Albania or in Bosnia-Herzegovina. On the contrary, many have been university students and others have actually been, it's more sort of, it's a different social group, really. There are some people, I have a Bosnian PhD student who argues that some of the facts that they've seen has been a spin-off from the Islamic student organization that have been run from Salafists, that have been very active in Sarajevo and elsewhere. I can't verify that, I don't know. I'm just, I don't myself speak the language, so when I read the newspapers, I rely on a Google Translate and my Bosnian student. And so I'm just saying that all I want here is really to raise a flag and say, we really should be concerned, not just about Turkey, but also about the Balkans. And the impact on the rest of Europe for these reasons.
Right here, and then the last will be next.
Hello, Jake Howery, also a current student in SSP. My question is specifically for Dr. Muro, but then we can open it up to some of the other panelists who have expressed skepticism with CVE. So I was hoping that you could speak somewhat to the issue of problems with micro-targeting in CVE strategies, so that when radical groups more narrowly target at their messaging, they become more effective, whereas states have some baggage that comes along with narrowly targeting in a group at that same level. The outgoing Homeland Security Secretary, Jay Johnson, has spoken somewhat to this of how his job is made harder going into Muslim American communities because of the rhetoric in U.S. politics that surrounds that. So if you could just kind of expand on your thoughts to that issue.
Yes, along the same lines, we have a critique of Prevent in the U.K., where Prevent has been accused of stigmatizing Muslim communities and actually making it more difficult to extract information from them or to simply collaborate or be in good terms. And I'm very much aware of that criticism. And it is a problem. That doesn't invalidate at all the idea or the necessity for CVE or prevention strategies as I increasingly know in Europe. I think that agenda is still necessary. I think it's essential to solve the problem at the medium and long term. And I think perhaps one of the issues that would alter or change the relationship between the state and minorities, no matter what religion, no matter how they are called, is the fact that prevention strategies shouldn't come directly from the state. The idea that a prevention strategy will function, will be able to de-radicalize, will be able to produce an autonomous and convincing and credible counter-narrative when it comes directly from the state and not members of their community themselves, charismatic leaders at local level, that's my belief, is false. So the state needs to be there, the government needs to be there, it needs to be the driving force, it needs to provide the funding. But let's be clear, a propaganda campaign with the logo of a state or the Department of Interior is not going to work. It's not going to convince anyone. So perhaps it's necessary, and I'm thinking about this in European terms. I'm not trying to teach anyone a lesson on this side of the pond. But certainly in Europe, the government has to sort of take a step back and act more like a facilitator rather than an agent that is fighting an open war with a group and with an ideology. If that continues to be the case, well, then civil strategies will never work.
Yeah, right in the back here.
Oh, yeah, thanks very much for your stimulating.
One more comment here.
No, so I want to address the CV issue because I'm certainly the skeptic of it. I mean, what I have found and have been fairly dismayed by is that there's a lack of science to this CVE stuff. And what do I mean by that? So if you went to your doctor and your doctor gave you a drug to fix, I don't know, liver cancer, and it had never been tested scientifically, you would probably run out of there, right? And so what I find very frustrating about DFID, USAID, is that the science that we would use to test any other kind of intervention, which is randomization, so that we can isolate the effects of the treatment, monitoring whether or not there are effects that perdure after the treatment has been complete, it simply doesn't happen this way. The other thing that I find really astonishing, and I've been through this enough because I'm an old lady, is that there's a rush to hurry up and do something without the science that undergirds the do something. So I've, you know, in South Asia, I've seen the whole gamut. First, everything was madrasas. We have to do something about the madrasas. Now in Bangladesh, we have to do something about the private universities. And they will make assumptions when about things that are causing a problem when those assumptions should actually be more properly phrased as an empirical question. So when I've looked at these CVE efforts in the countries that I've looked at, I think they've fundamentally been flawed because they're making assumptions about the nature of the problem when there's actually no science behind it. And I think the other problem is how we do business. So let's just pretend the CVE fairy was here and she told us how we can fix this problem. I guarantee you, by the time you give it to USAID, they will make a poo sandwich out of it. Why? Because it has to be scalable, right? They don't want to write $25,000 grants, but in fact, that's going to be the scale at which something is going to be effective. So the demands of scalability versus the demands of efficacy, I think, make trade-offs that really make this a disastrous gamble. So that's a view from the skeptic. Someone who's viewed it on the ground, someone who's looked at the conventional wisdom from an empirical point of view. I mean, I'll give you a really good example. I mean, my goodness, this just stuff makes my head explode. I don't know how many times those of us that do surveys of these countries, we find repeatedly that poor people support these terrorist groups less. Why? Because they endure the negative externalities of the violence. But how many of these CVE programs deal with this canard that poverty breeds terrorism? And this is just one of the canards, but in fact, there are numerous canards. So whether you're looking at the science behind it or what I would call the booking agency called USAID and also DFID and how they execute these projects, I just think this is not a viable way of thinking about this. It's a very effective way of making money if you're a Beltway bandit, that's for sure. But in terms of dealing with the problem, I'm far more skeptical.
David?
So I don't disagree with anything that Chris said, I'm less of a CVE skeptic. I am a skeptic of how it's been done. But what I'd like to point out is that this lack of science is so pervasive across all of our efforts. So one thing that my team just did is a review of monitoring and evaluation of counterterrorism capacity building programs under the Trans-Sahel Counterterrorism Partnership. And my Lord, like the way we do M&E for counterterrorism capacity, like talk about lack of science. Another thing I mentioned in my opening remarks is something which is much more falsifiable, which is basic analysis of what's happening in the CT realm, where we've had these major misreadings of events where I can't see anybody, like whether it's outside of government or inside USG, giving the kind of critique of their own analysis that they should. My lord, why did I get this wrong? I mean, that's what you should say when you misread basic events like the impact of the Arab uprisings. So I fully agree with Diego that I think that CVE is necessary if we can do it well. So one example I'll point to, which gets at the scalability problem, would be, and you know, full disclosure, I serve as a special advisor to this organization, but DHS's Office of Community Partnerships just gave out $10 million in CVE grants in the United States. And all of them were CVE grants that were applied for by local institutions. And you know, within the $10 million given out, there's over, I think there's 31 different grants, all of which are tailored to the specific problems of the community, which is precisely what you need to do. Now, check back in a year or 2 years to see how that turned out, right? We can't say right now that this is going to be a success story, but it actually gets at that problem of this, of scalability and big players coming in and applying a one-size-fits-all approach. There's no best practice, because any best practice is going to be fit to the needs of the specific community and drivers of radicalization within that community, as opposed to this overall archetype of what the problem is.
I hope to be able to come back. Oh,
yeah, I want to add. So actually, I agree with David more on this. I am, there's an anecdote here. I went to a CVE event at a mosque. I won't say which mosque it is. And it was directed for young kids in the catchment area for the mosque. And the purpose was to teach them about the dangers of listening to recruiters and telling them where to go when they were recruited or somebody tried to recruit them, et cetera, et cetera. So if this sounds familiar to you, those of you who are parents, it's because it was modeled on the DARE program, the Drug Education Program. And actually, the organization that delivered the program normally did DARE. So this goes to the problem of actually figuring out how to do things. So at this event, I went around and I sat down and talked to the parents who were present and said, do you like this program? What do you think is good about it? And said, yeah, I hope my son will become a cop. So the parents all thought that it was an opportunity for their children to get encounter good role models from the police department who were present there, part of this engagement. So obviously there were some good things that came out of it, in the sense that between the Muslim community and a mosque and a local police department, there was a great deal of trust building. However, I doubt that any one of these kids ever would have become a terrorist anyway. But of course, that cannot be proved. But the big problem is that most people get recruited when they are into this movement, not when they're teens, but when they are in their early 20s. Which means that we don't have any good institutional context for which to deliver this types of program to the direct risk population. Therefore, much of CVE and much of the benefit of CVE actually has to do with all of the other organizations and around families and local police, who becomes educated about what Islam actually is, who actually gets to meet for the first time perhaps in their lives a real Muslim, and therefore learn that actually the jihadists are just, they're presenting a perverted version. But that's a very different thing than what CVE promises to do. Now, I agree with this new program that DHS is promoting. Actually, this might finally push the territory into a different type of capacity building and realm.
I mean, all of us agree that it's a space that a lot more money has been poured into for programs that have completely under-delivered in terms of results, and that's a systemic problem we have. I think that's something we need to acknowledge, and part of what I would advise for anyone moving forward with policy is, you know, rather than pouring a lot of money in right away, take it a little bit slowly and concentrate on things that can, you know, programs that can show some sort of result scientifically. So, like micro interventions, for example, is one where We actually, if you're doing online microinterventions, you have the metrics where you can determine whether there are results or not. Now, I mean, there still hasn't been the same kind of, the kind of testing that I would like, but I think that within CVE, my hope is within the next 2 years, we'll actually see kind of a generation of CVE programs emerging that has a lot of value that the first generation didn't. But again, you know, check back in a couple of years and see how we're doing.
Yeah, I think, you know, but as Christine said, there's a lot of, you know, do something now.
Yeah.
You know, Anthony Cordesman said, you know, about a year ago, talking about employment of soft as strategic tokenism, just to show we're doing something. And so I think that's a problem. If we have time, I'd like to come back to messaging and digital messaging, because I have a question from our student National Security Critical Issues Task Force. You've touched on a lot of it, but I'll ask a specific question if we have time. We had one in the back here. Are you still have?
All right. Yeah, Rob Seller from St. Andrews. This question is kind of spinning off David's idea of startup terrorism. And in a millennial worldview, especially in the Western perspective, you know, we trust strangers to drive us places. We use apps to transfer money across borders to circumvent the banks charging us. And if I was smart enough, I would deal in Bitcoin. I'm just wondering, does that leave our society to be more vulnerable than ever through these industries that don't adhere to bureaucratic norms, which are under great scrutiny?
I think the bottom line is yes. You know, it leaves us more vulnerable, but it doesn't have to, right? I think that we tend to have systems that are vulnerable by design, and or I think a better way to put it, rather than vulnerable, I'd call it fragile. I mean, I think that one book I highly recommend, one of the best books I've read in the past few years, is Nassim Nicholas Taleb's Anti-Fragility, which you know, he's the same author who wrote The Black Swan, from which we get the term Black Swan events. And you know, his point is that the argument he makes is that the opposite of a fragile system is not a resilient system or a robust system, but an anti-fragile system. That is a system in which what happens overall, if a negative black swan happens, the system is indifferent to it. It can survive and even thrive. And if a positive black swan, that is, you know, for some industries, like a massive drop in oil prices, maybe it wasn't a black swan event, but most observers of the oil industry didn't see it coming, that they can then capitalize when a positive black swan occurs. And I think that's right. That's what you should aspire towards. Now, it's hard, you know, it's hard to get there for an overall system like ours, which is so intricate, so wound up in technology. And a lot of it's not the lack of regulation. I personally am a fan of deregulated spaces. I think a lot of it is the reliance on technology and interconnectedness, meaning that if there are weak links in the chain, entire systems can fall apart. I mean, we can see there's much more focus right now on digital vulnerabilities, but I think we're only really scratching the surface in that regard. So yeah, we have a system that's more fragile than it has ever been, and it's going to become increasingly so. And I think one of the things, in addition to what I put forward of trying to make our government less like a legacy industry and something with an organizational design that's better suited to the 21st century, the other big challenge is going to be, how do we create less of a fragile system and more of an anti-fragile system in all the things we rely upon, commerce, agriculture, et cetera.
Over here.
Hi, Sarah from SSP. My question is for Dr. Klausen, specifically about the social network analysis. I found that it was really convincing from an after-the-fact perspective, when you actually have had arrests and you've had attacks and you know who these people are. But particularly in the US context, I'm curious how you think this is applicable in terms of a preventative tool, and if you think it is applicable, then how you do this sort of social network analysis and balance that with civil liberties, which are particularly robust in the US as opposed to this kind of work in the UK, that they're a little bit stricter here.
Right. So I actually do the same analysis on the U.S. But I, as you say, there are limits to what I can do. I can only, I can't walk out and call somebody a terrorist, right? So I can only use public records that are related to verifiable events and convictions and death and self-declared affiliations, as in, I'm now with ISIS. Here's my picture of me. I don't think that this analysis it can't be used for predicting the next attack. Let's be clear about that. This is a type of structural analysis that can help you look at vulnerability and can help you look at the medium term. So I think one of the key advantages is that it sort of fills the gap between broader strategic thinking that is typically done in IR and intelligence work that's based on what we have, not how this report that sort of and looks just at what might be right over the horizon. And I think that it can help us. So in 2014, I wrote an article in Foreign Affairs where I predicted the number used past the number of returnees from past insurgencies and the number of returnees who had been engaged in violent attack, and then again discriminated against the most serious violent attacks, those with high casualties, and arrived at a predictor factor. You referred to some similar work that others have done, and it was pretty good. Now, a couple of years later, I would say, actually, I did quite good in my prediction. There was just one problem that I hadn't foreseen. And that was because the structural analysis I used from the previous insurgencies didn't account for the internationalization that we have seen. Because so I looked only at returnees. I hadn't foreseen that we now suddenly would have an influx of Tunisian, not European Tunisians, but Tunisians and Moroccans and other folks who to participate in what is essentially European networks. So there was an additional block there of folks that I hadn't anticipated because it was new development. So that's obviously, so I think that illustrates both the strengths and the weaknesses of this type of analysis. I'm myself actually quite fascinated by what you actually can do, provided you have the data.
Bruce.
In my abiding pessimism about the world and dyspepsia, I fasten onto the CVE discussion. Tell me if I'm wrong in this assumption. Isn't the foreign fighters' problem, almost at least in the West, a complete repudiation of CVE? I mean, these programs were put into place over a decade ago in many of the countries in Western Europe, in particular, the United States as well, where there's been the surfeit of foreign fighters that's unprecedented. So if CVE was a meaningful, I mean, isn't that one measure of effectiveness if we're producing foreign fighters, firstly? So am I right or am I wrong that if we didn't have these CVE programs that we may have lavished all this money on, there'd be an exponentially even greater number of foreign fighters than we have now? What made me think about this is in our own country, in Minneapolis-St. Paul area, because of course over a decade ago we had a huge problem with Somali Americans going off to join al-Shabaab. And at least in the immediate aftermath of the 2008-2007 period, there were tremendous resources pumped into that community that are, and I've seen them firsthand, they're extremely impressive. But of course, just a few years ago, about half a dozen Somalis from that community were indicted, not just for wanting to go overseas to fight for ISIS, but for having been ISIS radicalizers and having been recruiting more Somali Americans to go overseas. Or is that like a complete oversimplification?
Well, I think the first thing is that it gets to the problem that Chris articulated, which is the lack of science behind it. Right? You could make the argument either way. There'd be so much more. I think it certainly, I mean, I think it is a challenge and probably a repudiation of CVE as it had been done. I mean, I think that the lack of concrete metrics means that we can just determine based upon outputs. And so when we see the negative outputs that we're seeing, then that certainly challenges the models, including the PREVENT model. I think for Minneapolis-St. Paul, there actually is a good metric that can be used, because you have dual problems in Minneapolis-St. Paul. One of them is terrorism. The other one is Somalis being Somali gangs. They have a huge gang problem. And so, and basically, the kind of CVE programs they set up are actually designed to dual track and address them both. A lot of them are like youth soccer leagues and the like. So the thing I would look to is whether we have what the fluctuation is in Somali involvement in gang activities and correlate that to the overall fluctuation in community involvement in gang activities. In other words, if you have a rising gang problem overall but a declining Somali gang problem, that would actually be an indication that something in those CVE programs is working. And I don't know the answer as to whether they're working or not. But to me, whether or not CVE is a good thing doesn't depend upon past failures. And the reason I say that is because looking at where we are in 2017, it's almost like we're starting from square zero. And Bruce, you've seen that for counterterrorism work. I mean, obviously, there are some people, if you look back to the scholarship of the 1990s, I think it was far ahead, like the scholarship that you were doing and Dan Byman and Brian Michael Jenkins and others. I think it was a field that was much better than it would end up being in 2007, say. A lot of the discussions we're having today in 2017 are the exact same discussions we were having in 2007. And it's almost as though literally nothing was learned in that decade in between. So I think one of the challenges for efforts across the board, including and especially for CVE, is getting past that rebuilding the wheel every time. Because it's almost as though, like with the grants I mentioned from the Office of Community Partnerships, to me it's as though those grants are like a square zero. And I think that there was some improvement, a little bit, in that they're trying it on a community-based level and having the communities themselves apply for grants. That at least is an improvement. But it's almost as though now in 2017, we're back to square zero with a new set of programs, and hopefully we'll get good monitoring and evaluation for them this time around.
All right, I'm gonna ask, Professor English, last one, and then I've got to ask one question.
Thank you, Richard English. I'm normally the most pessimistic person in the room, so it shows how bleak a day it's been that I'm going to sound like the optimist. But I want to end on an almost optimistic note about CVE, which isn't to say that anything that's been said negatively about it is wrong. It's merely to put it in context of the other things we do in terms of public policy and ask whether they're any better. Because what you're describing is policy which is not based on scientific rigor or testing, yeah, and which repeatedly fails. But certainly in the UK and the US, if you look at the policy on drugs, if you look in the UK at the way the health system works, if you look at whether trains work, if you look at how education works, if you look at the obesity epidemic, if you look at young people's binge drinking, I'm not sure CVE is any worse, to be absolutely honest with you. In other words, I think what we may be describing when we focus on this effort to deal with terrorism is something which might actually be to do with the way in which we deal with policy. I mean, you've got a president now who appears not to believe in climate change, for example. So in that sense, it seems to me there are all sorts of areas of what we do where this is common. Indeed, it may even be that this isn't as bad.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, and I think it's more colorfully put, but basically the same thing I said in response to Chris at the outset, which is that the same problems that are identified with CVE actually apply to the whole range of CT programs. Now, the thing is that actually, in the US, there are spheres where we're quite good at getting metrics and massively improving performance. That sphere, the main one I'd point to, is sports. Like, if you compare the way that baseball was played in the 1980s versus the way it's played in 2017, it's a whole different game, right? And those of you who read Michael Lewis's Moneyball, or those of you who are kind of sabermetric nerds, will know what I'm talking about. And I apologize, it's an international audience, so for those of you, it's our version of cricket. But in the 1980s, people didn't know what would make a more valuable baseball player. Is it RBIs? Is it batting average? Do walks matter? For a pitcher, what matters more? Is it wins? Is it ERA? And now we actually have incredible answers to those questions, which allow you to value baseball players much better. And basically every team is using advanced metrics. It's made it a much more competitive game. There was one point where the Oakland A's were able to consistently reach the postseason, even though they had one of the lowest payrolls, because they were just playing a different game and valuing players way differently than other teams did. And that gets back to the need for, you know, a scientific way of doing this, which I think is absolutely possible. Not only in the CT, like, I think the CT sphere, I mean, that's the sphere I work in, but I think that principles that could be used to massively improve the CT sphere could be, and the CVE sphere could be used in other spheres of public policy as well. It's interesting. I think part of the problem is, in some of these areas, I think that if you get down to the question of what makes for a good analysis, you'll find many different answers. And there's much more focus on what argument wins out in the present as opposed to what argument ages well over time. I mean, I'd like to see a lot more monitoring and evaluation be applied to scholarship. Because if you look at there's a lot of fierce debates you've had in multiple spheres. And going back and seeing who's right, I think, is important for the question of methods and how to approach these problems. So look, I love that comment. And I will end but on my own optimistic note. I actually am an optimist in this sphere. And the reason why I'm an optimist is because I don't think we can continue to function with our policies costing so much money and getting so few results. I think necessity will at some point force it. With the massive debt that we have and all this money being poured into programs that just aren't working, at some point, someone, and hell, it might even be this administration, is going to say enough. There's going to have to, and maybe it won't be, this administration, but at some point that's going to happen, because this is not a system that's getting results and there are lives at stake, and it's not sustainable to keep doing this way and spending so much money and getting so little results. I think that's one thing that we should all focus on, the question of how do you get better results across the range of policy, and obviously here we're going to talk about counterterrorism. So we should focus on how do we get better results here, better results in our analysis and better results in the programs, CVE, CT, and the like, that so many resources have been channeled into.
Yes, I have a two-finger intervention as opposed to a middle-finger intervention. Sorry, just went in one of those moods. So the problem with publishing, if you try to submit this stuff to a journal, they only want to see positive results. Right, so if you look at science, you know, I don't mean social sciences, I mean biological sciences, physical sciences, there is a move afoot to actually publish negative results. And I think that's really important. Back in the day, many, many years ago, my first career was in studying biophysics. There was a lot of emphasis on publishing negative results because it's just as important to understand what didn't work as what does work. And I would like to make a call to those that are editing social science journals is that we actually have a forum to publish negative results. I think this is really, really important. So we've lost all the institutional memory, if you will, of all and essentially squandered money on these programs because we couldn't actually get the negative results into the public domain where they belong.
Kind of like intelligent people learn from their mistakes and wise people learn from the mistakes of others.
Yes.
I just wanted to push back a little bit on this scientism that my colleagues here have been advocating. I actually believe that one of the problems with the CVE agenda is that it's based on a mistaken analogy to public health policy. It presumes that there is a population at risk and we can identify the at-risk population and use prevention to prevent this population from going down the road to actually becoming a full disease. But there are no population indicators. It is, statistically speaking, a marginal problem. So terrorism is a marginal problem, and as Bruce and many others have said many times over, contact, happenstance, contingencies are all over the place. It's not like a disease that you catch because you do X or you are in touch with X. It's far more complex than that. So between the marginal problem with you know, making statistical inferences that you simply can't make because you don't know what the base population is. Some 30 to 40% of American arrestees have been converts. So the base population is the American population between the ages of 16 and 57, if you go by who has been arrested in recent years. That just doesn't work. So you simply cannot make these predictions. And then there's the civil liberties issues that come back. You can't actually create a control group. It's not possible to have a control study. It would be unethical. So we have this group over here. We think that they're going to be terrorists. We have this group over here. These folks are with Antim Chowder, which is your Rio 4 network. We can look at them. And then you have these other people over here who are doing something else. How are we going to create these control groups? There are no such thing. And if we knew there was a control group anywhere, and we saw anybody going anywhere, my university wouldn't give me permission to do this.
Well, that's not what we're saying. First, I want to say I totally agree with you about this idea that it's based upon a public health model. That has been an assumption that should have been a research question. Absolutely agree with you on that. But not all of the CVE programs really say, we're going to make you not want to be a terrorist. Like for many of the programs that you do in Pakistan, it'll be something more subtle. Like, for example, we want you to reject the certain message of, say, Hizbul Tahrir. Now, it is absolutely possible that you would randomize elements of who would get this treatment. It's simply not true that it can't be done. But the key is that you actually have to be able to. And then, of course, what is your dependent variable, right? These things are terribly specified in many cases. Yeah. But it's not true that you cannot randomize who gets the treatment. So what we typically see happening, based upon bad science, I totally agree with you that there's this at-risk population. We go and we put, like, for example, a really good example is Karachi. Karachi is just presumed to be festooned with aspiring terrorists. By the way, it's not entirely false. That there are other places that are festooned with aspiring terrorists as well. But it basically is the dog, tail wagging the dog, whatever the expression is. We go and put resources into places that we presume to be a problem. So it is that old problem of shining the light in that part of the closet, and you see where the light is shined, or light is shown. I'm not sure at the past, anyways. It
doesn't. You're the linguist.
Yeah, I know. What the heck? I think I've got Alzheimer's. So I don't agree that these cannot be randomized in a way that we can at least try to understand what's the effect of this intervention. However, I do completely agree that the entire scientific premise that this is public health is just completely rubbish for all the reasons that you noted, in violent agreement with you.
Well, this has been a great discussion. We've reached our time here. I owe our students, I was asked to ask a question, which I'm going to put out here. We won't get to it today, but maybe in tomorrow's discussion. But we have our own Georgetown Security Studies Review, which is our student-run peer-reviewed journal, that maybe they'll publish some negative things. The editor asked me to ask this question on behalf of our National Security Critical Issues Task Force, which is a course that we run. Professors Raleigh Flynn and Jeff Connor teach, and they do deep dives on lone wolf terrorism. And what they're working on now at the behest of a government organization is counter-messaging. And so their question is, you know, whether we believe that counter-messaging campaigns, and specifically digital messaging strategies, you know, should play a role in counterterrorism and CVE efforts. And you've already made a lot of statements about that. And I think, you know, testing and notwithstanding, the real question is, should we be investing in those and do we think they'll play a role? We'll table that question because I think that'll come up tomorrow. And so we will adjourn and we'll reconvene at 9 a.m. tomorrow. And please join me in giving a hand, a round of applause to this great panel. Thank you.